I always thought they were for men who worked in factories and machines and, you know, in auto industries and things like that. I never heard of a union for office workers, mm-hmm. mainly women. I didn't think that many women would be interested in having a union, and not that many women knew what a union was all about.
I really didn't have much of an impression. You know, I had the impression of big unions like Teamsters being corrupt, but I didn't think that that applied to all unions, and didn't have much experience with them and didn't know anything about them really.
I had been working in a department store before I came to work at BU, and I belonged to another union, and I had not been happy with the union there. The union and management in that place seemed to be a little too tight, and seemed to work for each other rather than for the worker. And so when I came to, also, and as anybody who's worked in retailing knows, that when you're at the sales clerk level, it's not much of a job. So when I came to BU, it was like Shangri-La. And my previous experience with the union having been fairly poor, I really wasn't interested in a union here. So I didn't pay a lot of attention to it.
I had been a teacher and also a musician, and still am, and had been familiar with unions, teacher unions and music unions, and was under the impression, and still am, that a union is for protection, and it was a very good idea, and I was all set to join as soon as I got here.
With low pay, poor working conditions, and lack of respect on the job, the clerical and technical workers at Boston University decided to organize a union. On May 24, 1978, they voted to be represented by District 65 UAW. The BU workers are unusual, however. They are one of the few groups of organized clerical workers in this country. Out of a workforce of over 18 million clerical workers, only 11% are in unions. Because of these small numbers, when clerical workers think about unions, there are not many examples to turn to. Stereotypes and lack of information, combined with the costly anti-union campaigns mounted by most employers, tend to make many apprehensive to consider organizing as a way to remedy workplace problems. In this program, BU workers interviewed 2 years after the union election share what their own personal experience of the union has been. They talk about what BU was like before the election, what difference a union has made to them in their own jobs, and how they have been personally affected by this experience.
I arrived 3.5 years ago when the union was in its pre-election stage. In fact, I think the first week that I arrived, I came back from lunch one day and found this memo from attorney John Hill, who apparently in his memo wanted to urge people to consider what having a union in the university would mean, and to make a decision based on what we felt was going to be best for everyone all around. At that point, I didn't know much about the union. I didn't meet anyone yet that could tell me what was going on. I didn't really know what he was talking about, and I just sort of passed it off at the time.
Well, when I came to BU, I wasn't that aware of fit. I mean, even before I came here, I knew that something was going on because I had friends who had worked in the library. But I believe that it was the union drive was beginning to go pretty strong, because that was when there was a lot of fuss about the clinic workers, the two people in the health clinic who had been fired unjustly, and there was a lot of publicity being given to that and around the union. And in fact, one of the people who had been hired to replace one of those workers, when they had to find another job for her because they had to rehire the workers, she came to work in my office.
Well, I came back from lunch one day and I found a copy of Coffee Break on my desk. I never even knew what it was, and I read it, and I realized that there was some kind of committee going on trying to get an election here at BU. And then eventually I met this woman who worked here. I didn't know she did, but I met her at the bus stop, and she told me there was union plans here and that I should come to a meeting. So I started going with her to meetings.
There were two girls in the office, and they came to me and they said, "We got a raise, you know, what did you get?" And they said, "What do you mean a raise?" You know, I was really in total shock. And this was, I guess, a year and a half, you know, after I was working there, and I really got kind of mad. And I gave my notice, you know, and said that I was going to get a transfer. But, you know, these two girls in the office were very active in the union, and that's what, you know, got me started.
Well, I was working in the physics department and met one of the organizers, Barbara Rocky. I think she was one of the beginners who started talking about the union to me. And one day she came down and she said to me, "I think the union would mean a lot to you and your situation." And she went over some of the things, mainly that it would be supportive. And at that time, I knew nothing about unions. I had nothing at all. My family had never belonged to union. So I signed a card. And this was beginning.
In 1974, the BU staff had begun talking among themselves about the possibility of organizing after BU replaced the annual cost of living increase with a merit raise. BU's merit system had a limited pool of money, thus putting staff in competition with each other for the money, and the raise for most would not keep salaries anywhere near the inflation rate. In addition, the staff recognized that other conditions at BU, such as unfair firings and lack of equitable and fair personnel policies, needed to be changed as well. The staff organizing committee picked District 65 as the union to represent them because of its democratic nature and commitment to organizing women and minorities. The union's success came after a two-year struggle with a hostile administration that attempted to thwart the union drive. BU tried the traditional tactics of stalling the election date through complicated legal procedures and by developing an atmosphere of fear and intimidation on campus through their use of a well-known union-busting firm, Modern Management Methods, or 3M. Staff were warned that if the union were voted in, they would have to punch time clocks, they would suffer from a highly regimented office, that District 65 was going bankrupt and only wanted their dues money, that they would have no say in the union, and that once in negotiations, they stood to lose even the benefits they already had. Using these tactics, 3M had been responsible for busting the union drives in many of the Boston area hospitals. BU paid 3M over $250,000 in the hopes of a similar success.
Well, before the election, it was a real atmosphere of intimidation around here, I feel. There was a lot of propaganda, I feel, flowing from the administration about certain aspects of the union, which they blew out of proportion in order to make people afraid to vote for the union. I feel a lot of it was exaggerated. Some of it was outright lies. They exposed the financial records, and apparently one dubious payment, several thousand dollars, turned out to be a transfer of funds to Tom Mooney Hall, which was a union hall. Things like that, making it seem as if the union would appropriate funds from the people's union dues and do whatever they felt like with it without telling the people how they used funds. They made exaggerations about fining people for not coming to meetings, firing people for not paying their dues, which I have never seen. I've just never seen this type of action from the union.
I feel that this type of activity would be more appropriately coming from the university administration than from the union. And just about everything that they predicted would happen, negative that is, has not happened.
Well, I know the supervisors, you know, in the office, like my supervisor, they used to have meetings at personnel, and, you know, the people in the personnel office would tell them what to say, and, you know, why not to join the union and all this. And we would get letters practically every day, sometimes twice a day, you know, how bad the union was, and, you know, you could lose your job if you joined the union, all, you know, sorts of things like that.
I did vote against it in the election, but I felt really strongly once it had been won. I really went back and forth before the election as to how I was going to vote. I read all the literature that came, the tons and tons of it that came out of the Office of Personnel, the equal amount of it that had come out of from the union, and I was pretty turned off by the stuff that was coming out of the Office of Personnel, but I really didn't know. And you know, although I was offended at the way personnel was presenting it, I wasn't, you know, I really didn't know how much of it to give credibility to, because just because it's being presented obnoxiously does not necessarily mean that it's entirely false. So there was that, and, you know, and then there's just the fact that, you know, the status quo, there's a certain security in that, and having been in a union that I hadn't liked once before, I figured, well, maybe I'm better off dealing with one crummy organization, the administration, rather than having to deal with two crummy organizations, the administration and the union.
They changed their story from unions aren't any good to, yeah, unions are fine, but this union isn't the one for you. Like, they had one in mind somewhere along the line that would be good for us and that we shouldn't vote for this one. They basically tried to tell us that they had our best interests in mind and that they could represent us better than we could represent ourselves. We had a meeting during the anti-union campaign where we were supposed to get our grievances out and talk to the administration. It was the last meeting we had, by the way, of that type. And people did give their grievances and said how they didn't feel they were what they thought was being taken into account, you know, that they basically weren't being treated very well. And one of our, after hearing all these grievances, one of our more pompous administrators got up and said, and this is a quote, "Life's unfair, it always has been and it always will be." And that's what we were offered as an explanation for our grievances. And I think basically we had more hope that we could get something out of it than for ourselves than they could give us.
Although the election was in May, the union was certified by the Labor Board in December due to challenged ballots. Once certified, the union wrote to BU requesting a date to begin negotiations. BU's response to this came in the form of a letter from the Vice President for Business and Financial Affairs, Charles Smith. The letter read in part, quote, "I received a communication from you which might have contained at best a check or at least a Christmas card. Imagine my surprise when I opened it and discovered it contained a letter. My disappointment knows no bounds. Sincerely, Charles Smith."
Went out on strike because basically they just wouldn't recognize our union as a legitimate union. And we were certified at that point. We had been certified for quite a while, and one of the major strategies that the university has been using is what we call the big stall, this tactic of just slowing things down so that they either don't happen or they happen with very much effort on our part. So in April, the beginning of April, when the faculty was having difficulty in its own negotiations and the administration refused to sign their contract, they went out on strike and we walked out with them and then voted later on to call an official strike, calling it a strike for recognition, which is an unfair labor practice strike.
Well, the faculty was out on strike, and there was talk of us joining them in support. And I remember going to a meeting over at, I believe, Newman House or somewhere like that, and Hillel House. And it was really a good meeting. It was exciting. People were excited, and they were yelling, and they were talking loud. And there was just this excitement in the air. And I remember they said, you know, we're going out. And I had left work at 12 o'clock, and I said I'd be back, told my supervisor I'd be back But I didn't go back. I didn't even call. I marched up the street, and I remember feeling really good about myself.
We'd never been on strike before. I'd never been part of a union before. But it had tremendous effect on me. Those memories, even though they're almost 2 years ago, are vivid. It was a time of really forming close relationships with people. I mean, working on something very meaningful to us, to the faculty, to us as a clerical technical union. It affected me a little bit financially, but, you know, I got over that, and it wasn't really a tremendous setback. But mostly, I think the effect was positive in that we really learned what it was like to have a union, to have solidarity, to be working for our own causes, to have more control and more input into our lives. And that, I think, really started me feeling that I have this control over my life. I have a union to help me, and therefore, you know, I have much more self-confidence.
Well, it was mixed feelings. I was happy about being out on strike. My children, I have five children, they're very supportive. They thought it was great to have their mom out on the street in the picket line, and they were very happy about it. They just felt it was a new me coming out or something, and they were thrilled. I remember worrying mainly about finances, and I wondered how I was going to make it, how we were going to feed ourselves. But as it turned out, everything went fine.
We had to go on strike. We won our election. We said we wanted the union here, and they contested it. The NLRB ruled that we'd won, but still they wouldn't do it. So in order to actually be recognized and negotiate a contract, we had to go on strike to do it. And we spent 2 weeks on strike getting that, in a really difficult time for all of us. And we won, you know, we won. It was just fantastic. It was just the greatest thing that ever happened for all of us, or for a lot of us. We've spent a lot of time. This is like the first time that any of us ever joined together and worked for something together and felt the power of all the workers here working for something. And we were proud of ourselves. And when we came back in, it showed. And people started treating us differently because we had a union.
BU workers had to strike for 2.5 weeks in April for recognition, and once again that fall for a week over contract issues. Since that time, however, the BU administration and President John Silver have revised their opinions of the secretaries they once called cream puffs and have shown a newfound respect for them and a recognition that they must take BU employees seriously. In the 4 years since the first contract, BU workers have successfully concluded two more contract negotiations without striking. From the time of the first contract, BU workers have increased their salaries over 36%, won increased benefits, job security, health and safety protection, particularly for VDT users, and protection from sexual harassment.
After the contract went into effect, that there seemed to be a unification that came about in the library, in the particular place that I work, whereby that since almost everyone in the library is a member of the union, seem to just pull together and support each other and just be there when things were needed to be done, and that's the kind of feeling that I get from the contract being in effect.
There have been a lot of things that have happened. There's some of them subtle and some of them not. After we got the contract, when people had a problem, they'd go to the steward, and the steward would go talk to the supervisors, and the supervisors listened.
Well, I had an incident in my own work where I did get a promotion, and I had had been told that I would get a raise, but it wasn't forthcoming, and after several months, nothing was said, and I had nothing in writing to prove this, so I called one of my steward, and I talked to her, Laurie Norse, and she told me that of my rights and what I should do to pursue this thing. So at this point, I felt very good about it. I felt like I had some concrete basis, some support that I could really go ahead. And I did talk to my chairman and told him that the union leaders would be willing to come over and talk to him. At that point, he did get a raise through for me. So I felt that, I really felt good about it.
Another example, this is a real example, I feel, of how people are vulnerable. People in our type of work are very vulnerable to the desires and whims of our bosses. And that is, one day I came into work to find this note on my desk, and I was required to serve coffee to a meeting. And not only was I required to serve coffee, but I was to ask the other meeting members to call them on the phone and ask them how they like their coffee. Now, it clearly states in our contract that this is something that secretaries and anybody covered by this contract is not required to do. If you want to, that's fine, but you don't have to. And since in my particular office, I feel that too many times I'm required or asked in some form or another to do very service-oriented tasks, and this is not part of our jobs. As secretaries, as clerical workers, we're not servants or waitresses. It's okay to have that as a profession, but within our own jobs, we have a particular function, and coffee is not one of them. So I just copied the page in the contract that stated this, attached it to the memo, and said, no, this is not one of my functions in my job as secretary. And had I not had the contract, I would not have been able to do something like that without some form of disciplinary measure coming down on me. In fact, my boss did attempt to do some kind of disciplinary measure. He typed up a 4-page memo about this incident, calling it a management grievance and sending it to the personnel department, demanding that they send me written notice to that I was required to perform these tasks. But they never responded, and I believe that's because we do have this protection in the contract, that they didn't even want to touch it with a 10-foot pole for those reasons.
There were so many things I didn't know about as far as, until I read the contract, as far as sick leave and, days that I can take off, what I'm entitled to about my rights, and I felt that now there is quite a bit to fall back on.
For the BU staff, whatever their level of involvement in the union, whether as union members, stewards, negotiating committee members, or officers, the impact of the union has gone far beyond contract issues.
Well, one thing is just a greater sense of community. And in fact, that was one of the things that was a very pleasant thing for me when I joined the union. Before I joined the union and became active in it, I knew the people in my office. There were one or two other people I knew around campus. But I wasn't a part of BU. I was a part of the student employment office. And then through the union, I got to know people from all over campus with all types of different jobs. And I became part of the BU community. And that to me was very important because, of course, we don't work for the Student Employment Office, the School of Management, the College of Liberal Arts. We work for Boston University, and we all have interests in common.
It took away a lot of the isolation. It's a very small office, and the only people it seemed like the world consisted of these faculty and art history students. And by joining the union, I started meeting a lot of other clerical staff, and my community at the university broadened tremendously. I became a steward and attended steward meetings regularly, and cultural events and films and all those things that provided opportunities for people to get together.
I think it's changed my attitude towards my job in that I feel it's much more tolerable and that I do have this to back me up if I do have any further problems. About myself, I definitely feel more confident about my abilities to take stands, to stand up for my rights.
I definitely think I'm standing up for my rights a little more, and I'm a little more aggressive, and things that come up that I'm not sure about, I get in touch with the steward or I read the contract. I look into things now that I know that before I just let slide by. I was too worried about my job to care. Now I feel if anything comes up, I won't get fired. I'll have support. I can look into these things and not have to be afraid.
It was the first time that I'd been involved in a group effort to change to change something in a positive way. And I think I've been pretty cynical about that being possible, and cynical about clerical workers just not thinking for themselves and looking down on themselves because other people look down on them. And it helped my self-esteem in being on a picket line and being active about thinking about what I was doing and taking a stand and letting the people who I worked with know what I thought of what I was doing and that it could be better and it should be better.
I was for unions, and regardless of the union I would have joined, but I think before I came here I basically saw them as being bureaucratic structures, much like business. And my experience with 65 here has been that it's democratic. The union isn't anything outside of us. The union has been us. It's been the workers. And we've got help from people outside when we needed it. But basically the organization and keeping the union going and the decision making has been our decision making. And I'm really impressed just by the democratic character of it.
I've been fairly impressed with it partially because it's not what it was accused of being. It's not a bunch of men sitting around in New York making decisions for us. It is, in fact, District 65 is my co-workers and myself making decisions for ourselves. I feel very strongly that the benefit in a union isn't what a union can do for you, it's what it allows you to do for yourself. And some unions that I've seen, the way they operate, they don't really allow their members to do that much for themselves. In fact, they actively work against their members doing much for themselves. And 65, it seems to me, really encourages each of us to do it for ourselves.
It means that I have the basic groundwork for improving my working conditions along with other people who are also unionized, and I have voting rights, ways of expressing my feelings towards things, my stance on different issues. So it in a lot of ways, just being part of District 65 has opened my mind and expanded my vision that I'm one of many organized workers in this country.
Well, I always felt that we were really put down. I feel very strongly about secretaries, being a secretary myself. I feel that we need all the support we can get, and we deserve a lot more than we're getting, and that's what we're fighting for.
My faith in you.